on a Saturday. But first, what we learned this week and why it matters. Monday was a huge day. Paul Manafort and his associate Rick Gates surrendered to federal authorities to face charges for tax fraud and money laundering. And we learned of the guilty plea of former Trump foreign policy advisor George Papadopoulos of lying to federal authorities. That day, the president spoke with former advisor Steve Bannon, who reportedly encouraged Trump to take a harder public line with special counsel Robert Mueller. That might have been good political advice, a means of salving the president's base, but this was the week that the story became more legal than political. And while the noise will certainly continue, the outcome of the special counsel's probe will now be determined by critical thinking and the rules of evidence, not the nightly exchange of competing cable TV narratives. Much has now come into focus. We now know that George Papadopoulos had conversations about the emails of Clinton 2 months before there'd been any WikiLeaks release of John Podesta's email and long before any report of the DNC having been hacked. Here's the timeline. Podesta's email was hacked on March 19. On April 26, Papadopoulos met with a professor of international relations who claimed to have substantial connections with the Russian government officials, at which time he was told the Russian government had collected dirt on Hillary Clinton in thousands of emails. On June 3rd, Donald Jr. was similarly told in an email that Russian representatives wished to provide dirt on Hillary. He then took a meeting on June 9 along with Manafort and Jared Kushner. On June 14, CrowdSource detected the DNC hack. On July 22, WikiLeaks dumped 20,000 DNC emails. Then came October 7, when within hours of Trump's Access Hollywood tape being exposed, WikiLeaks dropped Podesta's hacked emails. And now the New York Times is reporting that Trump advisor Carter Page, in contradiction of many previous statements, told the House Intel Committee that he met with a Russian government official during a July 2016 trip to Moscow and sent an email to the campaign. Altogether, that timeline substantiates lots of interaction between Trump campaign representatives and Russians just as the hacking was taking place and its results rolled out to the benefit of the Trump campaign. The unanswered question is whether anybody from the Trump campaign aided the hacking, whether there was actual coordination within that chronology. Recent developments do call into question the president's assertion made on February 16 that he knew of nobody from his campaign who'd had contacts with the Russians. Attorney General Jeff Sessions said likewise in a January hearing before the Senate Judiciary Committee. What exactly the president was told at a March 31st meeting where Papadopoulos was present with Trump and Sessions, that's going to be critical. Meanwhile, the president is clearly continuing his public campaign against the probe. That was reinforced with his tweet storm as he left for Asia yesterday. But the only way that any of that matters is if the prosecution is derailed or if the Congress ignores it. Throughout the campaign and in the first 9 months of President Trump's administration, his base has supported him, regardless of what he says or does. With the Russian probe, it seems there will again be no impact of his words or actions, but for the opposite reason. Because no matter the president's bluster or tweets or capital letters or threats, Mueller's not listening to any of that. Now it's all about the rule of law. That's how I see it. But what about a soothsayer who claims that, well, facts are overrated? Back in March of 2016,